Well, good morning. How many of you are happy to be here? Okay, I'm assuming if you didn't raise your hand, you're not happy to be here, but just thank you for choosing to be with us. If you've got your Bible with you, take it out and turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If you don't have your Bible with you, there's one provided for you. It's a copy of the ESV, and you can pull it out. And I forgot to look and see what page that's on, but you can pull that out and look in there and get caught up. We'll be in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, but actually I'm going to back up a half a verse, and when I get through with chapter 13, I'm going to read two words of the next verse because you're going to see how it all comes together. What I want you to take home with you today is this, though. And you may not know this. Probably a lot of you do, but I bet there are some people in here that do not know this one piece of truth right here. When love is the motivation for all that a believer does, not kind of motivation, but when love is the motivation for all that a believer does, they overcome sin's effect on themselves and the world. And all God's people said. Amen. Now, how many of y'all still have a problem dealing with sin from time to time? Okay. How many of you believe the world is still full of sin? We all do, okay? All of that can be wiped out by the love of God. Because after all, God, love is not just a noun. Love is not just a verb and an action. Love is God Himself. It says in 1 John, God is love. Would y'all say that with me? God is love. God is love. Faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. We're going to see. We're going to understand that God is love. Now, the love chapter, as it is known by many, is the solution that Paul has given to the church at Corinth. There are 16 chapters that we broke them up in chapters after Paul read the letter. There are 16 chapters, and in that 16 chapters, there's somewhere between 8 and 10 major problems that the church at Corinth had. For example, the church at Corinth had a problem with division. There were some standing on this side and said, I'm with Apollos. There's some over here on this side saying, I'm with Paul. And there were even some over here on this side saying, I'm with Peter. I'm with and there was division in there. And what Paul does is as he writes this letter, everything is moving towards chapter 13. Because chapter 13 is the solution to the problem. Because if the people really loved each other, there wouldn't be divisions, but everybody would be together. And then he goes on and we get in chapter 5 and we see in chapter 5 where he's talking about sexual immorality. And the solution to sexual immorality is if we really love God and we really love people like God tells us to love in chapter 13, that's going to take care of itself. And then he goes on and he begins to talk about food sacrificed to idols and idols. And the reason that people have the idols is they love God more than they love people. So that if that would be solved, if people would just love God with the agape love that God wants them to have, that would be okay. And then in another chapter, he gets on to them because when they gather together to observe the Lord's Supper, instead of loving each other and making sure that everybody has something to eat, there's a division among them then, and some are trying to take care of themselves. We got to take care of ourselves, so you just going to have to fend for yourself. Love would solve that problem as well. Like I say, there's 8 or 10 problems all contained, even to the fact of the resurrection and the misunderstanding that they have of the resurrection. But if they could just get this thing called love to understand that, it would solve every single thing, every single problem that the church at Corinth had. But I'm going to go so far today as to say that if we can understand the love of God, agape love, as it's written in the Greek language, when we can understand that kind of love, it will actually, the depth of that love will push the sin out of our lives. The depth of that love will push the sin out of the church, and the depth of that love would carry all the way into humanity, which is why God sends us out to share Christ with other people. In other words, when love is the motivation for all that a believer does, they overcome sin's effect on themselves and they overcome sin's effect on the world. Now, love in this sense is not a noun. It's not a feeling. You know, most people fall in love, they say, I'm in love. You know, people come to me for counseling all the time before they get married, premarital counseling, and I'll always ask them, why do you love each other? And I say, well, usually I'll ask a guy, I say, why do you love her? He'll say, because she's so pretty. Yeah. But, and then I'll continue to ask, I say, well, how do you know you love them? She says, I can just feel it on the inside. I can just feel I'm in love with them. You know, what I really don't say to them is this, but I want to say what you feel on the inside is not really love. What you feel on the inside is lust. Because you think she's so beautiful, and you're thinking, you're not thinking love, agape love. You're thinking love, eros love, like the hearts and the little guy shooting the arrow and all those kind of things. When God's love is so much bigger than that. It's so much broader than that in our lives. If the people were to do all the things they do out of love, if you and I did everything we love, out of agape love, God's love, all the church problems that we ever had would disappear. All the problems in our families, all of our emotional distress and disorders would disappear. God, as love, provided propitiation for our sins. In other words, Jesus Christ came and took our sin upon himself so that we wouldn't have to experience that to save us. What do y'all think the most famous verse of Scripture is? If you had to pick out one, what would you say the most famous that the world knows the most? John 3:16. Y'all help me. For God so loved the world that he... Stop! For God so loved the world that he gave. Now, it is amazing that he gave his son. But we can get that love is not about getting, but love is about giving. It's about not filling yourself. It is about giving yourself away. The Bible does not say, for God so loved the world that he received us unto himself. It says, for God so loved the world that he gave himself to us. He gave his Son. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all are one. God is love. Therefore, Jesus Christ is love. Jesus is the Father. Jesus and the Father are one. So he gave himself to us. So to demonstrate to us what love was, he gave himself away. He gave himself to be a sacrifice so that we could get that. And chapter 13 of the book of Corinthians is going to help us see that better than any other place in the Scripture. Probably if the whole Bible can be summed up in one verse, it'll be John 3:16. But if the whole Bible could be summed up in one chapter, I'm going to say it's 1 Corinthians chapter 13 because it's saying exactly the same thing, but it's giving a little broader understanding of it to each one of us. Now, having said that, let's go ahead and look in the Bible and let's begin to read. But I do want to say that in your Bible, there's a set of parentheses. You may be able to see it and you may not be able to see it. You know how somebody will be writing a letter and they'll put a sentence or a piece of a sentence in a set of parentheses because they want to block this off because it's one main thought that they want you to get. There is a set of parentheses around this in your text. And that's the reason I want you to look at in chapter 12, the last half of the last verse before we read 13. You see where it says, and we'll show you, and I will show you a still, what's those next three words? More excellent way. All right, that's one part of the parentheses. And then look at chapter 14. And then after he tells them that excellent way is love, he closes it out with the parentheses and he tells them to do something. What does he tell them to do? Pursue love. Okay, you see how he's got this blocked off in here so we can get the text that is there. Now, having said that, let's go ahead and read chapter 13, verse 1. Now, if I speak with the tongue of men and angels, but I have not love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have, and if I deliver my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist in its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, and it believes all things, it hopes all things, it endures all things. Love never fails. As for prophecies, they're going to pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. Now, when I was a child, I spoke like a child, and I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up my childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, but the greatest of these is love. Faith, hope, and love. Faith is turned into sight. Hope is realized, but love endures forever. Love endures forever because God is love. Okay. Let's start off. First thought I want you to think this morning to think about is a saint's motivation must be, not needs to be, but a saint's motivation for love must be love. The saint's motivation must be love. Everything that we do has to be done out of love. And that's what Paul is talking about in the first three verses of that thing. If you notice, he said, if I speak with the tongues of men and angels, if I can sound like an angel, if I can have the voice of God as God delivered his word to the angels, to the people in the Old Testament, if I can do all of that, it's of no value if I don't deliver it based on my love for you and based on my love for God. Or if I do, it's no more than a big loud sound. And if I have prophetic powers, and I can tell you other things that other people don't know, and if I can understand all kinds of mysteries that are unattainable to understand by the human mind, and if I had all the knowledge of everything that there was, but I don't have faith. If I have all faith so as to say to the mountain, say to that mountain, be cast into sea, and I could cast it in the sea, but I had not love, that kind of faith is of no value. If I gave away all that I have and I delivered my body up to burn, but I do not love, I gain nothing. If I can jump in front of you with a bullet, get shot, save your life, but I don't love you, I've gained nothing. The motivation for what I do has to be love. Guys, especially listen to this next line. Ladies, you're going to love this next line. Okay? Why you do what you do matters more than what you do. Is there any lady that'll lay me in that? Oh, any lady, like half of the ladies in here, I mean that. Why you do what you do matters more than what you do. The guy says, you know, the argument between a husband and wife, you know, you could have washed the dishes for me. Okay, I'll wash the dishes. Aren't you happy I washed the dishes? No, I'm not happy you washed the dishes. Why are you not happy because I washed the dishes? Because I had to make you wash the dishes. I wanted you to want to wash the dishes. And the guy says, why in the world would I want to wash the dishes? The ladies are going, say, that makes perfect sense to me. The guys are going, huh? Why you do what you do matters more than what you do. Guys, you ever wonder why you messed up with your wife or your girlfriend, but she still loves you, and she's tickled pink when you blew everything? It's not because you succeeded at what you did. It's because of why you did what you did. A saint's motive is never to be self-love. Okay, this is the way the world works. A man chases after a woman because he wants the woman so that he can have a sexual relationship with the woman. So he's wanting the woman not because he loves the woman, but because he loves to have sex. Okay, did the preacher just say that from the pulpit? Yes, he did. And by the way, there's another saying I say quite often around here. The truth is the truth, whether you believe the truth is the truth or not. Okay? All right. But now when a man falls in love with a woman and he pursues the woman and he loves her with all of his heart, the woman knows that the man does what he does because he knows the man loves him. And there's a huge difference between those two things. What we do matters to God way more than what we do, because our motivation has to be because we love God. A saint's motive is never to be self-love. It is always to be love of God and to be love of others. Now, the world wants you to be happy. Satan wants you to be happy. Your flesh wants you to be happy. So many people do what they do in seeking happiness, but sooner or later you'll find out that no matter how hard you seek to make yourself happy, you can never make yourself happy. Okay? Don't do what you do because it makes you feel so good. Do what you do because God loves you and you want to share that love with the other people. And when you can figure that out, your love will change completely and you'll be experiencing the agape love that God demonstrates in the whole of the Bible. The whole of the Bible talks about the love of God. Anything, and the Bible says anything not done out of love, anything not done out of faith or love for God is of no sense. Anything not done out of love for God and others is of no value in eternity. That's why the text, Paul writes, I gain nothing. What agape love looks like. Let me talk about that for a minute. Let's look at the text. What agape love looks like. And then he gives us verses 4 through the first couple of words of verse 8. Love is patient and is kind. It doesn't envy or boast, and it's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but it rejoices in the truth. In love, it bears all things. It believes all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love never ends. Now, agape love is not the same thing as eros love. Eros love is that kind of love that somebody has for a man, for a woman in a relationship, and they want to seek after each other because they lust for each other. And then you have the Philadelphia, the word comes from, which is a brotherly love, which David and Jonathan had for each other, but that's not what the New Testament is talking about when it says agape love. Agape love is the divine nature of God. He is love himself, and that love cannot exist apart from God. Now, you've heard me probably, if you've been here 52 weeks out of the year, probably at least 50 of those 52 weeks out of the year 2018, you probably heard me quote a verse of Scripture that said, God demonstrated his love for us. And while we were yet sinners, what happened? Christ died for us. Y'all ever heard that verse before? God demonstrated his love. So there's a demonstration, not a definition of love, but a demonstration of love. Love is not about a feeling. Love is about an action. Because why we do what we do causes us to do what we do. Okay, so God, it's a demonstration of how much God loved us. So how much did God love us by sending his son? He loved us so much he sent his son to take our sin upon himself, have a crown of thorns placed on his head, a nail driven through his hands, a nail driven through his feet, to be beat with a cat of nine tails, to have him slapped in the face and spit upon, hung upon the cross for half of the afternoon so that he can cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Because he's taken on the sins of all of humanity for all of the believers of all of humanity for that single moment. He who knew no sin became sin for us and was emotionally devastated. Because he took? No. Because he gave. Because it's about what's going out. Love is a sacrifice. It cost. You know, God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. We didn't demand that he send his son so that we could be saved. God chose to give his son. Therefore, it requires there be a sacrifice. Now, I'm going to go ahead and let you in on a little secret. Jesus emptied himself and he became obedient even to the cross. In other words, he died and gave his life to be the sacrifice that would take away our sins. And he requires of us that we sacrifice ourselves back to him. Paul says this. He says, "For I am crucified in Christ, so it's no longer I who lives, but it is Christ who lives in me." Now, Paul didn't die literally on the cross at this point when he's saying these words. But Paul meant figuratively, we're emptying ourselves like Jesus emptied himself and became obedient to the Father so that he could be crucified. Jesus said these words, "If any man would come after me, he must do what? He must deny himself," how often? "Daily, and take up his cross and come and follow me." So our spiritual act of love is a sacrifice to God so that we empty ourselves of ourselves. And when we empty ourselves of ourselves, there's a vacuum inside of us which is filled with the love of God, which is filled with the Spirit of God, which is filled with Jesus. And after all, Jesus is the Spirit of Jesus, and Jesus is also God. And as God, he is love, so we are filled with love. And then that becomes the motivation for everything that we do. Now, love is emptying oneself of self like Jesus did. It said in Philippians 2, 7 and 8, "But emptied himself by becoming in the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross." So as we die to self, we're filled with the love of God, and then we can begin to love people as is described in chapter 13 of the book of 1 Corinthians. And then we have patience. It begins to change who we are. When you have emptied yourself of yourself, you will love like the text describes. Let's look at these descriptive terms and see how when our personal needs no longer drive us, we are emptied of our emotional pain, and agape love fills the void that is in there. Okay, if you have truly been crucified on Christ, on the cross, so it's no longer you who live, but it's Christ who lives in you. If you have truly taken up your cross and come and followed Christ on a daily basis, if you have become, as it says in Romans, a living sacrifice, so that you have emptied yourself of self, you know what happens to your patience? It's eternal. Now, let me ask you this question. Why do you get impatient with the people who are in your life? Just think about this for a minute. You're impatient with them because they're not working according to your timetable. All right? Right? You get impatient because things are not happening like you want it to. Suppose you don't exist. Do you have a timetable anymore? No, you do not. Therefore, your patience becomes eternal because God is eternal. Let's look at kindness. Why are people unkind? You know why most people are unkind? Because most people are unkind to them. Anybody in here ever had anybody that's unkind to you? Anybody know what I'm talking about? You ever had anybody throw darts at you? Shoot zingers at you? Somebody shoots a zinger at you, and the first reaction you have is to shoot a zinger right back at them so that you can zing it back to them and just really let them have it. And you really let them have it. Why did it bother you when you got hit? The reason it bothered you when you got hit was because there's too much you in you instead of Jesus being in you. Because if you've died to self, you no longer exist. So when they threw a dart at you, they missed. That reminds me of when I was playing Cops and Robbers. Anybody ever play Cops and Robbers or Cowboys and Indians when you're growing up? We used to play in my neighborhood, and, you know, we'd make guns out of sticks and everything. We were so poor, we had to make believe everything. We'd find a stick, and we'd point at somebody. We'd say, "Pow, pow, pow, you're dead, you're dead." You know, somebody fall over dead. They'd come to me, and they'd say, "Pow, pow, pow, you're dead." I'd say, "Jew, jew, jew." "No, you didn't. You missed me." "Jew, jew, jew." "No, many times they shot." "You missed me." "No, I shot you." "No, you didn't. You missed me." Well, let me tell you what. If you're not there, they'll miss you every time. Love is kind. No matter how many times, if you've emptied yourself of yourself, no many times they shoot a zinger at you, it ain't going to stick. No many times they throw a dart, it's not going to light. Love is without envy. Why does envy exist? Envy exists because you don't have what somebody else has and you wish you had what they had. But if you don't exist, then envy wouldn't exist. Because you exist, envy is why it exists. Okay. Boasting. Why do we boast? We boast because we want people to think more of us than they think of themselves. So we want to tell them all of our accomplishments. You ever been in one of those conversations where people keep saying, you think that's something? You got 12 stitches in your arm? Look here, I got my arm cut off. I mean, somebody's always got something, but they're always boasting about, look at me, what I've done. But just think, if you didn't exist and you started boasting, who would you be talking about? I'll tell you who you'd be talking about. Jesus Christ. Because his love would have filled you because you no longer exist in you. You know, maybe we could talk about being happy or wrongdoing, because somebody rejoicing over something terrible that happened. All of these descriptions that are contained in here exist because we exist. And we do what we do because it makes us feel good. Agape love is not motivated by feeling. Agape love loves because we love God, and we love God because he first loved us. So it's a reflection of the love that he has in us. What love does? Paul talks about that in his text, right? For now I see dimly, but then face to face. Now I know partly, but then I shall know fully, as even I am fully known. Well, that doesn't make any sense today. I mean, you ever think about, how many of y'all looked in the mirror this morning? Let me check and see. Hold your hand up, because I want to see if some of y'all actually looked in the mirror or not, okay? Nah, I know every one of y'all looked in a mirror this morning. Some of you are so vain, you got one of those mirrors on your dressing table or where you shave, and you flipped it over so you had the magnified side on there, and you start, look at that, I'm getting so old. And you started looking at all those things. The mirrors that we have today will show you more about you than you ever want to see. And somebody said, amen. Yeah, okay. I heard more women, amen, in that time than I did men. But anyway, the mirrors we have are wonderful, but the mirrors in Paul's day were not like that. The mirrors didn't work as well as water did. Back in the old days, Paul, you look in the water, you see your reflection. If the light was in the right place, you see your reflection in the water. You could see, but now they had an old shined up piece of metal or something they were looking in, and that was the kind of mirror that they had, so everybody looked a little fuzzy. So Paul is saying, while we're in the body, where we're still there, and we've not yet been crucified in Christ, so it's no longer we who live, when we look, we see very dimly. We see something that looks really fuzzy. And the reason it looks fuzzy is we're in the way. You ever been trying to look in the mirror? Somebody stepped in front of you. You couldn't see what was right before your eyes because they were there and you couldn't see the mirror. That's what we do to ourselves. When we look in the mirror, what we ought to see is Christ. Because we've emptied ourselves of ourselves. When we empty ourselves of ourselves, it gives clarity to sight. Love causes us to be able to see better. Sin, on the other hand, is all about self. It's about pleasing yourself. Adam and Eve first sinned because they wanted to please themselves by eating the fruit that looked good. You and I sin because we want to please ourselves with the sin that's dangled before us, so we partake of it so that we can enjoy of it, only to find that we've sinned. So sin is, in a nutshell, selfishness. It's about us wanting what we want when we want it. Self over God. Self over others so that we can have what we want. When you remove your selfish desires from the equation, fear, anxiety, anger, lust, hate, arrogance, and all of the other negative emotions that we have are moved out of the way because you no longer exist to feel those emotions that were there. Now, death of self-centeredness allows you to see the perfect love drives out fear. And that's what it says in 1 John 4:18 is these words. And I didn't get this years ago. I really didn't get this. 1 John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. Now, if you know that the person with a gun in their hand loves you the way that God loves you, are you going to be worried they're going to shoot and kill you? No, because they've got that agape love. So it takes the fear out of the equation. When we love each other with agape love, we don't fear what the other person is going to do. We don't fear the consequences of the love that we have because we know that God loves us with that kind of love. Now, that love requires a relationship. And Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross restored your relationship to God and your relationship with others. You know, you didn't know Christ, but God woke you up and He saved you, and then you developed a relationship with Christ. You have been reconciled to God. Now you have peace with God because you've been reconciled with God, because for God so loved that He gave. He emptied Himself. Jesus emptied Himself and gave you Himself on the cross. And now your relationship is growing and thriving, moving the relationship that it should go. What if all the husbands would empty themselves of themselves and love their wives, and everything they did because of love for their wives? How do you think the wives would feel? Pretty good. That's what agape love is. Love gives us the ability to endure all things. Gives us the ability to hope all things. It gives us the ability to believe all things. And your emotions don't have to dictate how you feel. So how are you doing? How clearly do you see now? How clearly can you... Are you looking in a dim mirror now because you're in the way and you can't see Christ because there's so much of you in you that you're looking at? How clearly... You know, just ask yourself a couple of quick questions. Number one, are you impatient with people? If people are not moving according to your time schedule is more important than your love for them. Are you unkind to people because they've been unkind to you and you just want to get a zinger back on them after they zing you? Are you irritable are you irritable towards the other people that you come in contact with? Are you arrogant? Think you deserve better than what you got? If you think you deserve better than what you got, you just made it all about you. And if you made it all about you, you could know that you've not been crucified in Christ. So it's Christ who lives in you and not you in you. Are you happy because something bad just happened to somebody and you thought to yourself, I'm glad they finally got it? If you're happy, that's not Christ that's happy in you. That's you that's happy in you. Are you pursuing love for God like Jesus pursued you by emptying Himself and become obedient to the cross? You know, Ephesians tells men, love your wives like Christ loved the church. Christ physically died for the church. But I don't believe He's talking so much about us physically dying for our spouses. I don't really think He's talking about us jumping in front of the bullet. I think He's talking about us being crucified in Christ. So it's no longer we guys who live, but it is Christ who lives in us, so that we can show our wives what agape love looks like, so they can show their children what agape love looks like, so that we and our wives and our children can show the world what agape love looks like. Are you full of yourself and need to die to self and come and follow Jesus? Jesus didn't ever say to somebody, hey, you want to be saved? Come to me. Now He'd walk up to people and say, come and follow me. And they either decided to follow or to walk away. Those who followed found the most love they'd ever seen in their lives. Because for so God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Dear God in heaven,